Уважаемые коллеги, мы присутствуем на защите докторской диссертации Соискатель Купавский Андрей Борисович. Тема «Семейство множеств с запрещенными конфигурациями приложения к дискретной геометрии и зависимости». Значит, я иногда буду то же самое говорить на английском, поскольку в аудитории присутствуют англоязычные наши коллеги. We present at the defense of PhD, doctor thesis of Купавский Андрей from the Department of Discrete Mathematics, MIPT. The title of thesis is Families of the Sets with Forbidden Configurations and Application to Discrete Geometry. Андрей, you have for about 40 minutes, please. Значит, слово предоставляется Константину Войтикову.
Поступило заявление от Купавского Андрея Борисовича 5 февраля 2019 года из искания ученой степени доктора наук по специальности 05-13-17. Все документы представлены. Копия диплома о высшем образовании, копия диплома кандидата наук по специальности 01-01-06, 01-01-09, два положительных отзыва Троегородского Андрея Михайловича, МФТИ и Малышева Дмитрия Сергеевича, Нижегородский исследовательский университет, заключение об апробации МФТИ, диссертация и автореферат диссертации в нужном количестве. Работа принята к защите протоколом FM-2019-4, 15 февраля.
All submitted documents satisfy requirements of MIPT. Now you can start, you have 40 minutes.
Thank you. So let me present my work. I'll, as you know, talk about families of sets with forbidden configurations and applications to discrete geometry. So I'll try to make this as expository as possible, to not going into too many details about the results, and then explain the general feeling of the field I work in. So I work in extremal combinatorics. As you can judge from the name, we're working with combinatorial objects, and we search for some extreme. So you have a quantity, and then the of interest to you, and then you have a class of objects, and the goal is to maximize the quantity over this class of objects, or minimize the quantity over this class of objects. Combinatorial objects are typically finite structures, such as graphs, hypergraphs, families of sets, polytopes, words, etc., etc., etc. Probably the simplest structure is the graph. Let me explain what it is. So what is a graph? We have a collection of vertices, a set of vertices marked by blue points here, and then some pairs of points are connected by edges, so that there is a collection of pairs of vertices that we call edges. This is a structure that is very useful to kind of abstract some important properties of the networks and of different real-life objects. So graphs may as well look like that. You can think of social networks or road networks and so on. But in some cases, graphs are not quite enough for our purposes, and the relations are more complicated than just binary relations, or relations between the two vertices, and then from graphs, we have to pass to hypergraphs or collections of sets. So most of the work is devoted to extremal set theory, and extremal set theory is a part of extremal combinatorics, where you work with families of sets. So now you have a finite ground set, which was the vertex set. And instead of pairs of vertices, you have a subset of vertices. And typically, you want to find the largest family satisfying certain restrictions. So let me give you a couple of examples of results in extremal set theory, some of the important results, so that you get a feeling for the field. I guess I'll space also. So the first result that I show you is so-called Sperner theorem, probably the first result in extremal set theory. The question is as follows. You have an element set, and then you want to take as many subsets as possible so that none is contained in the other. So this kind of situation is forbidden. So this will forbid one set in your family contained in the other. And then, if you think about it for a little bit, the first example the most natural example you would come up with is just to take all sets of some fixed size. And if you look at all sets of some fixed size, then of course the best would be to take them of roughly half of the ground set. And this is exactly what this is exactly the best what you can do. This is what Sperner's theorem tells us, that the largest such collection would be just all sets of size and half in your n element set. So it is a feature of many results in extremal set theory that you expect some simple configuration to be the best possible, and then the goal is actually to prove that it is best possible. So in this case, the simple configuration is just one layer of the Boolean cube. Another very important result is the Kruskal-Kapener theorem, which, for those who are familiar with it can read it, it's a lawless version of Kruskal and Kapener theorem, and it's a pleasure for us to have Julia Kapener here in the committee. The result basically deals with the following problem. If you have a collection of k-element sets, how many k-1 element sets would be contained in at least one of them? So this is what is called the shadow. So you take a collection of sets and you look at all sets that are contained in at least one of them on the level k-1. And the Kruskal-Kapener theorem gives us the best possible result. So it's a sharp, not in this form, but it is a sharp result that will tell us if your family is of that size, then the shadow is of that size. And it's difficult to see from the numbers how good or bad it is, but I'll give you some corollary of this result. So imagine that this is the way I draw a Boolean lattice, so all subsets of an n-element set. Here we have sets of size n-1, it's n-element set, n-2, etc., k, and then some smaller and smaller sets, one-element sets somewhere here. Abstraction of the Boolean cube, and then of course, it's easy to prove using some averaging that if you have an alpha proportion of sets here, say half of the sets or 1% of the sets on this layer, then the number of sets that would be contained in the next layer would be also at least 1% and so on and so forth until here. But what Kruskal-Kapener will give you actually is that not only this percentage would stay the same, but it actually increases quite quickly. So if you started with 1% here, then somewhere here you would get 99%. So the number of sets that would be contained in this small part would be actually very, very large. This is the basis of all kind of threshold results for monotone properties, for example, and very, very powerful tool. So another result that is probably the most important for my work in some sense is the Erdős-Corrado theorem. The result goes as follows. If you look at the collection of k-element subsets of an n-element set in which any two sets intersect, so no two are disjoint, then the best you can do, and again it's a very simple example that you would come up with, is just to take all sets containing a fixed element, and this is the statement of the theorem. This is the best you can do. So actually I'll even explain you the proof. For some case, n equals say 3k. 2k is too easy, but let's do n equals 3k. In general, when n divides k, k divides n, then it's an easy theorem. How would you prove such a thing? Just take three disjoint sets. They will cover up the whole ground set. So this would be elements 1 to k, k plus 1 to 2k, 2k plus 1 to 3k. Out of these three sets, since all of them are disjoint, you can take at most one. So here you can take, one third of the sets that you have here, just one third. And then actually, well, you can either average or reduce configuration, and even better, there is a decomposition of all sets on k elements into triples like that. And out of each triples, you would be able to take one set. So in total, you can take at most one third of all sets. And this is exactly, well, 3k choose k. So the binomial coefficient 3k choose k is exactly 3 times 3k minus 1 k minus 1. So you can take that many. I should write it like that. This is the bound from the Erich-Corrado theorem, and this is the bound that we showed, one third of all sets. Okay, so enough, I guess, for the introduction to extremal set theory. So if I want to summarize my research in just two lines, what I do is combinatorics of families of sets, as I showed you, and then its connections with discrete geometry, both ways. So now I'll go through different parts of my dissertation. The main part, or the biggest part, is devoted to Erdős-Corrado theorem. This we have already seen. I said that this is tied for the family of sets containing a fixed element. All sets containing a fixed element, this is what I would call a full star. It's a very important theorem in many ways. One of the reasons is that there are several completely different methods how one can prove it, and then it's kind of a theorem on which you can test different methods in extremal combinatorics. So, as combinatorics and extremal set theory developed, people ask different questions related to Erdős-Corrado theorem. One of the questions was about stability of the Erdős-Corrado theorem. So we know that the theorem is tight, but what if we forbid this example of a trivial intersecting family, well, when every set contains a fixed element? Because of course, if you have a full star, you can remove one set out of it and it's also intersecting. But what if you say that not every element contains, not every set contains this element? So in other words, given the distance from a star, in some sense a distance, how big could an intersecting family be? And also, how far could it be from a star? How far an intersecting family could be from a star? So this is part of the results that I obtained in the dissertation. The key notion here is the diversity of a family of sets. So it's really one way to formalize this distance that I mentioned. So just the number of sets not contained in the largest star. And with Dima Zakharov, who was at the time a high school student, a very, very brilliant high school student, we proved that some strengthening of result of Peter Frankl from the 80s. And we gave a tight stability result in terms of this number of elements not contained in the largest stars, in terms of diversity. And somehow the result is good, and it's very useful, as I'll show you on the next slide, but it works until a certain moment, and the moment is when the diversity is n minus 3, choose k minus 2, for some reasons. So as long as the diversity is smaller than n minus 3, choose k minus 2, then this result is good. But if the diversity is larger, then we cannot really say anything, and that was somehow strange. So this, by the way, this diversity is a diversity of a nice family, which is a family of sets containing at least two elements out of elements 1, 2, 3. So this is you fix three first elements, and then you say your family is all sets containing at least two of them. Of course, they would be intersecting, because they would be intersecting on this three-element subset. And apparently, it has this diversity, it's relatively large. And so this question was also interesting to Frankl, and he asked, actually, is it true that you cannot have a diversity larger than this for most of the parameters? And this is what I managed to prove. Actually, if n is bigger than some, I don't know, million k, some absolute constant k, then this is the best you can do. You cannot have diversity larger than that, which nicely complements this result, because in this result we gave it this tight stability result until this point, and then we say that, well, there is nothing beyond that point. I'll say a couple of words about the proof. It's interesting. It's really not a hard result, but the combination is nice because it uses extremal set theory to classical combinatorics, and it combines it with analysis of Boolean functions and junta approximation. So some terminology that comes from social choice that I hope you like. So what is a junta? Something that is, there is a situation in the country, there is a junta. It means that the country is ruled by very few people. Dictatorship is the country is ruled by one person, junta is ruled by few. And in our case, it's very similar. So a junta is a family that depends on very few elements, very few coordinates. So as in this situation, we were looking only at the first three elements, and judging by our intersection with these first three elements, we knew, are we in the family or aren't we in the family? So this is an example of a three junta, because the size of the set that defines everything is three. And in general, we can define a C junta. And using these juntas, one can prove many very powerful results in extremal combinatorics. The proof would go roughly as follows. You start with any family. Then you find a good approximation by junta with small center, constant size center. Then you solve the problem on these juntas with this constant size center. And usually it is easier for some reasons because they're much simpler. They only depend on constantly many coordinates. Then you know the solution to the junta problem. And then you know that the optimal family that you have must be close to it. And now the problem from kind of global problem reduces to this local problem, just to say that if the junta was approximating well your family, then there was no point actually to change it, because changing the junta just by a little bit only makes things worse. So this is the philosophy. This is what I used in my proof. And then the properties. This laptop gives slides in a completely messy way. I'm really sorry about it. The fonts were very different. So the properties that we need is that the center is of constant size of the junta, so it depends on constantly many coordinates. That junta possesses the same properties as the family. So if we want an intersecting family, then we must get an intersecting junta. And it must approximate the family well. So most sets should be inside, most of the sets from the family must be also inside the junta. And the same, one more word, this is the kind of structure versus quasi-randomness framework that is used for many things such as regularity lemma, very powerful things in combinatorics. So there is a structured part, there is a quasi-random part, and a very small remainder. This kind of decomposition is very useful. So one of the things we used it for is the result that I showed on the previous slide, is to determine a typical structure of an intersecting family. Apparently most of the intersecting families are stars, so trivial. And we also did a couple of things for cross-intersecting families. This is when you have two families, and any set from one intersects any set from the other. Mm-hmm. They appear naturally in this context because if you want to do some kind of induction, you start with an intersecting family. Typical things to do, if you have a family, a typical thing to do is to decompose it into two parts. Elements containing one, sets containing one, and sets not containing one. And if this was intersecting, then these two become cross-intersecting. So actually, if you want to do any kind of induction, typically you have to work with pairs of families. So not only it's interesting in its own, but it is also useful for proving things about intersecting families. Do I answer the questions by the committee members now? Is it a part of?
As you want.
I can say a couple of. I guess it's a good point. So there were a couple of questions. Notably, Drew asked me several things. One of the things: can we go further and prove similar results. Like most of the families with diverse diversity, at least 10 have actually diversity 10. Or like most of the families that are not stars would have diversity 1. Most families that have diversity not 1 and not 0 will have diversity 2. And this kind of results we can indeed prove. We did it for the non-trivial families. We can go farther, but we didn't write it. Another thing that that you mentioned is that the question about structure of the large intersecting families. Indeed, Dhruv and Sasha Kostichka did a nice result about that. And not just looking on the diversity of the family, but the actual structure. And then I, as you know, also generalized this result by a lot, but somehow it didn't, it wasn't published on time, so I couldn't include it in the doctor's case. So I kind of put this topic aside, but I'm very much interested, of course. it is indeed, there are several questions here that one can ask. You have a property, but you also kind of try to get away from the star, and then it is indeed an interesting topic. So for example, for the diversity result, there is this Hund approximation that I showed, which is imprecise, but with some combinatorics, you can get precise Hund type results. So if you go away from this family, you can indeed prove that the diversity would be lower. Somehow, one has to find a good general statement. I didn't think of it at the time, so I just wrote it for the way I wrote it. Okay, so the second part, which would be, each next part would be smaller than the previous one. So this part is it's a generalization of the previous questions about matchings. So what is a matching? If you think of these disks as sets, a matching is just a collection of pairwise disjoint sets. There is a famous question by Erdős, still unresolved, which asks, what is the largest family of subsets of 1 to n, size k, as before, but now without a matching of size s? If we put 2 here, without a matching of size 2, it means without 2 sets that are disjoint, which means we are talking about intersecting families. So if you put s equals 2 here, then it's exactly the intersecting families. And it's a very interesting question, still unresolved, as I said, and for a change I'll give you a small application of this question. I'll talk about distributed storage allocation for a minute. Imagine that you get a file to store on n vertices with redundancies. Somehow this is a question of storing things, retrieving things. You store it on n nodes. And the total budget of that you have, so the total amount of information you can store, is s times the size of the file. So here are your 6 nodes, and then you start to distribute your file somehow, so the red parts go on each node. And then, well, you cannot count that you would be able to access all the nodes, but you get an access to some nodes. And one natural model is just to take k nodes at random. So in this case, 3 in red. You get access to these 3 nodes, and you say that you would be able to recover the file if the total information here is at least the size of the file. Clearly, it's a necessary condition, because if there is not enough information here, no matter which coding scheme you would use, you wouldn't be able to recover it. But of course, it's not sufficient in the sense that you have to have a good way to encode your file and split it, but we want really to look at the distributed kind of part of the problem. So the question is how to maximize the probability of retrieving the file. So this question that people actually in computer science people studied, it turns out to be more or less equivalent to the question that I showed you on the previous slide. It's just the fractional version of the Erdős matching conjecture. So what is the largest family of sets of size k with fractional matching number s? So it's a relaxation of the Erdős matching conjecture. It's simpler, actually. Here are my results. Here, well, I'm cheating a little bit, so this result didn't appear in the dissertation, but I still wanted to mention it's a nice result, again, because it wasn't published by the time. We did improve the well, improve the bounds on the Erdős matching conjecture answered in the largest known range of parameters, we get the stability of the extreme in the sense that I was explaining for the Erdős quadratic theorem. If you are not the extremal example, then you're significantly smaller. And we also studied two related problems. One of them is the Erdős-Kleidmann problem from the 60s, which is the same question as the Erdős matching conjecture, but now we do not ask the family to be K-uniform. So sets can have any size, also no matchings of size S. And we also answer it in the largest known range of parameters. Also importantly there, we managed to develop a method which is an averaging method and it's based on Katona's circle method that Dula used to prove Erdős quadratic theorem. And this averaging technique allowed us to completely resolve another nice question from the 60s by Kleidmann, a bit of arithmetic character. What is the largest family of subsets without a partition? A partition is two sets that are disjoint and their union. So it's a little bit like some kind of progression. This we completely resolved. So this is these were the matchings. So actually, all of this we can take some kind of more geometrical or graph theoretical perspective on all this, and then look at Knezer graphs. So what are Knezer graphs? Vertices we have already seen many times, K-element subsets of an n-element set. This is what we were working with. And edges connect disjoint sets. So here you have a five-element set, and then each vertex you would mark two elements that correspond to this vertex. This is K5-2, which we already saw before, this Petersen graph. And then you see that these two things, they're disjoint, so they're connected by an edge, but these two things, they share, well, this element in common, so they are not connected. So these are Knezer graphs, and just to translate Erdős-Corrado in these terms, the Erdős-Corrado theorem says that the largest set of, the largest independent set in Knezer graph, the largest set of vertices without edges has size n minus 1 choose k minus 1, because sets without edges here are exactly the intersecting family, because if you have intersecting families, it has no edge, no disjoint pairs, no edges. And this is one famous result about Knezer graphs, but another famous result, very important, very influential in combinatorics, is the Lawless theorem about the chromatic number of the Knezer graph. So what is the chromatic number? It's the minimum number of colors you need for the vertices so that no two endpoints of an edge, so no two vertices like that or like that, get the same color. So this is the chromatic number. And the chromatic number of Knezer graph, well, by Knezer it was shown this at most n minus, it's at most n minus 2k plus 2n. This is really easy to see. Well, it's very easy to see that it's at most n. How would you see that? Well, you have your set of n elements, and then you can color all sets containing, say, element 1. Everything that contains element 1, you color by color 1. There are no edges there. Everything that contains element 2, you color by color 2, etc., etc. And then you use n colors. Well, you can be a little bit more intelligent and kind of not use this at the end and use something else, and you will get this bound n minus 2k, take 2k plus 1. The complicated part was to prove the lower bound, to show that it is tight. You cannot find a better coloring. And this is what Lovas did. He used topological, he introduced topological methods in combinatorics, proved it. And a bit later, very quickly after that, Shriver showed that actually not only Knezer graphs have such a large chromatic number, which was large somehow compared to what what the other bounds would give, but also a very small subgraph called the Shriver graph of it also has the same chromatic number. You can get this Shriver graph by deleting lots and lots of vertices here and look at the graph. But there is another kind of, this shows somehow that this graph is, I mean, definitely not chromatic critical, and it's kind of stable. This chromatic number is some kind of stable. You can remove some edges, remove some vertices, and still the chromatic number doesn't change. But what I was thinking is that, well, what if instead of deleting some fixed part of the graph, we will delete a random part or a random bit of the graph? Probably the most natural way to do it, one of the two most natural ways to do it, is to consider random graphs. So what is a random graph? You take any graph you like, and then you keep its edge with probability p. So you can imagine for each edge, flipping a coin, and if it's heads, then you keep the edge, if it's tails, you don't keep the edge. So then we can use this thing for Knezer graphs, and this is kind of what is left is, I mean, or what you delete is exactly kind of this random bit of the graph that I was talking before. So for a wide range of parameters, I show that even after this deletion, the chromatic number of the Knezer graph is very, very close to the maximum possible. It's just, instead of n minus 2k plus 2, it's n minus 2k minus 2 at least. And then we did, this used some topological method initially, and later we used, together with Sergei Kiselyov, who's here, we used some more combinatorial methods, and it's an interesting, and got better results. It's an interesting problem because here there are different kinds of methods of probability, combinatorics, geometry, and topology that meet, and then you can kind of test different approaches. So there are really interesting questions that arise also along the way. So we were talking about this Knezer graphs, and now I'll switch to a seemingly unrelated thing, distance problems, but then I'll explain that these two actually are very much connected. And I'll talk about distance graphs. This is one of the problems that is somehow dear to my heart because this is what I started with when I was a student. This and the next problem. So the chromatic number of the plane or the space, what is the question? You are trying to color the plane, so it's completely different from what we saw before at the moment. We're trying to color the plane and in minimum possible number of colors, really assign a color to each point of the plane, to this continuum of points. And we want to avoid the situation when two points at distance one have the same color. So how many colors one would need. On the plane, this graph, If you look at it and play around this graph or this graph that is drawn here, you see that it has chromatic number 4. So if you only look at these points, you need 4 colors to color them because all these edges have distance 1. So this structure needs 4 colors itself. On the other hand, this is the coloring of the plane in 7 colors. So here, each hexagon has diameter slightly less than 1, so that there are no points of the same color inside one, but between, say, this green and this green, the distance is bigger than 1. So also, you don't get points of the same color. Recently, there was a computational breakthrough by a biologist who managed, the Gray, who managed to prove that the chromatic number is at least 5. That was big news a year ago. But I was mostly interested in the asymptotic behavior of this thing. So what happens when you work with the same problem in RD and D tends to infinity. So there is a bound by Regorodsky that gives you some constant to the D bound, so it's exponential in the dimension. And actually this bound is attained on some finite configuration, which very much resembles this Knezer graphs that I showed you before. And, we'll use a notion for that. We'll call the graph a unit distance graph. Basically, if vertices are points in the space, so just finite number of points in the space, and we connect the points that are distance 1 apart. So this thing is actually bound on the chromatic number of some distance graph. And it's no wonder that we use this for the chromatic number of the space, because actually, as Erdős de Bruijn theorem tells us, the chromatic number of the space is equal to a chromatic number of some finite graph. So I also looked at the class of this unit distance graphs, and I was wondering, can you maintain this exponential growth of the chromatic number while putting different restrictions on the class subclass of unit distance graphs that we have? And my inspiration was this result of Erdős from 59, probably the first or one of the first big triumphs of extremal probabilistic combinatorics, and which I learned from Joel's book, actually, one of my favorite books in probabilistic method, even literature included. It's on the same level. So the result is as follows, that basically you can have graph with arbitrarily large chromatic number and without arbitrarily long, short cycles. So that it says, tells you in a very strong way that chromatic number is by no means a local property, because if you look at any vertex and its neighbors and the neighbors of the neighbors and neighbors of the neighbors of neighbors, you'd only see a tree. So some structure that has no cycles, just structures looking like that, without any cycles. This you can color in two colors very, very easily. But globally, still it will have huge chromatic number. And Erdős, what he did is, instead of constructing such a graph, he proved its existence using probabilistic method. That was a great result. Then later, Lovaas managed to construct this graph, but 10 years later, it's much more complicated. This proof is half a page. And I asked a similar question for distance graphs. And apparently, we can prove a similar thing. So we can also find distance graphs whose chromatic number grows exponentially in the dimension, but they don't have short cycles. And, the proof is also probabilistic. And I'm cheating a little bit here, well, not a little bit actually, I'm cheating a lot, because there is a very big difference between two notions of these distance graphs. One of them is when you say that whenever two points are at distance one, they're connected by an edge. This is the complete unit distance graph. So whenever you have a distance one, you connect them by an edge. And there is a notion that, well, if you're connected by an edge, then two points are at distance one. So if, or if and only if. And this result is for the second class. So I allow myself to remove edges even if the points are at unit distance apart. And if you ask me, is there the same result for this complete unit distance graph, so all the edges drawn, there is nothing like that. The best we can do, and well, I worked with it with Noga alone, and the best Noga even could come up with is the bound of the form d over log d. So instead of constant to the d, exponential growth, a sublinear bound on the chromatic number. So this is a very interesting question. Can we at least beat d and construct some such graphs explicitly? Okay, so the other problem is the Borsuk's problem, very much related. Actually, Lovaas was using the result of Borsuk, which says that you cannot partition sphere in d dimensions into d parts of smaller diameter. And then Borsuk, once he proved this, he asked this question, is it true that actually any set of diameter 1 can be partitioned into d plus 1 sets of strictly smaller diameter? Well, the answer is yes in dimension d less than or equal to 3, no in d dimension at least 64. This is how you do it on the plane, in some sense, for anybody of diameter 1. You find a suitable hexagon with distances between sides of 1, and then you cut it into three parts like that. So it's relatively easy in d dimension, for d equals 2. In 3 you can do the same proof, and then it breaks. And actually, Kahn and Kalai in 93 constructed a counterexample. And the counterexample, again, was a finite set of points, as for the unit distance graphs. And this finite set of points was basically the same as we saw for these points for the Knesser graph. So what was it? Before I mention what was it, I'll present you my results. No matter what it was, all of them were lying in spheres of radii close to 1 over square root 2. It's also not surprising, because you would expect such graphs, such finite sets, to form large cliques, so many points at distance 1 apart. So at least you would expect to have a triangle. And if you have a triangle, then this thing cannot lie on a sphere of radii
less than 1 over square root 3, because this is 1 over square root 3, if this is 1. And then if you want to have large simplices, then the radius of this sphere that you have gets closer and closer to 1 over square root 2. So then we asked with Regorodsky, are there counterexamples on spheres of radii that are close to 1 half, that are 1 half plus epsilon for arbitrarily small epsilon? Then you definitely forbid any kind of triangles, cliques. You also forbid all kinds of odd cycles, because actually if you want an odd cycle of fixed length, then there would be a fixed epsilon smaller than which you cannot go. And it turns out that you can do it, and you can actually have an explicit construction. You can even have epsilon tending to zero as d grows, and relatively quickly, or relatively is maybe 1 over log d, but still it's not something completely outrageous. So this is actually all these constructions are related to the following result of the following problem and of Erdős and Sörös and the result of Franklin and Wilson. It goes as follows. The problem that Erdős and Sörös asked was very much similar to the Erdős Crowder theorem, except now we were looking for the families of sets that would not be disjoint or intersect in zero elements, but instead would intersect in exactly t elements for some t. So you put t equals zero, that is Erdős Crowder setting. But the most interesting t is roughly k half, or, well, expected kind of intersection. And then it turns out that forbidding just one intersection makes your family much, much, much smaller than the whole set. So from if your whole family was roughly 2 to the n, then forbidding just one intersection, you go to constant to the n, where constant is smaller than 2, so you get exponentially smaller families. And How is it related to what we saw on the previous slides? Well, actually, so here is the connection to geometry and the Knezev graphs as well. So if you look at subsets of 1 to d, then you can identify the subsets with vectors in 0, 1 to the d. So if you have an element, you put a 1. If you don't have an element, you put a 0. So from the collection of sets, you get a collection of points or vectors, depending on the perspective, in a d-dimensional space. So this is good. But then, what about the intersection? So intersection size is actually just a scalar product between two vectors. And given that all the vectors in our case are of the same length, because the sets were of the same size, then this scalar product corresponds to the distance. So actually, this problem, if you interpret it as a problem on a Boolean cube, in high-dimensional Boolean cube, then you get to questions that are very much resemble these questions about the chromatic number of distance graphs or independence numbers of these distance graphs. Okay, so the best bound actually for this problem was proved by Regorodsky using, instead of 0, 1 to the d, he used minus 1, 0, 1 to the d. So this 1.239 I showed was using a bigger set of points. And Regorodsky realized that it's actually beneficial for you. And he asked a general question, like, can we extend results on this that I showed you on the restricted intersections to families of vectors from minus 1, 0, 1 to the n? So the results on families are 0, 1 to the n results, and what about minus 1, 0, 1 to the n? And then with Peter, we managed to prove some theorems. Turned out to be much harder. We still use some methods from extremal set theory. One thing that we managed to solve exactly is it's really ridiculous. So knowing how easily one can prove Erdős-Corrado theorem is, this is an analog for vectors that have k ones and exactly 1 minus 1, just 1 minus 1. And then the proof from half a page goes to 20 pages. So solving it exactly is very hard. Asymptotic bounds are okay, but this part is very hard. Do I have maybe 5 more minutes? It's okay.
Less.
I'll try to go over the very last part quickly about epsilon net. So far we were talking about well, geometric problems or combinatorial problems, but all of our objects were finite. So finite graphs and hypergraphs. We also can look at geometric objects like half space, polytopes, and things like that. So when our elements, instead of just abstract sets, would be, well, elements like points on the plane, and we would look at the half plane as in on this picture. So the sets of this form. One thing that is very influential in this kind of geometric type problems is the notion of an epsilon net. So what is an epsilon net? It's basically a hitting set. If you have a collection of sets and you can measure them, like one is bigger, one is smaller, so it's just a hitting set for all large sets. So you want to have a point in each large set. Large meaning at least epsilon measure. And then the measure you choose you like, it can be at least epsilon and points out of n, or volume at least epsilon, or anything like that. So here, for example, this is your collection, and this is your epsilon net. And this thing we ignore, we don't hit it. We did hit these two rectangles, these two, but this one we ignored because it's too small. And a key result in these geometric kind of set systems is the theorem of Hauser and Wetzel, based on Wapnik and Chervonenko's work, which says that if a family of sets has finite VC dimension, like, I know I haven't defined what is a VC dimension, but it's some characteristic which is typically, property that is typically satisfied for geometric things, then we can construct epsilon nets, and the epsilon nets would not depend on the size of the family, it would only depend on this epsilon and the VC dimension. So just these two parameters, the family can be arbitrarily large, but these two parameters enough to get well, small parameters, small epsilon and d, enough to get a small epsilon net. But moreover, you can get it using random sampling. So you just take points at random from your, well, probability space or from your space, and then you get your epsilon net. And it has very, very nice applications, algorithmic applications. Well, I wanted to show you this kind of cutting thing, but I guess I'll just skip it, because otherwise I'll have problems. And just the very last result, basically with Janos, Nabil Mustafa, we managed to answer an old question about the how large can be the epsilon nets for d-dimensional for half spaces in d dimensions. So if you look at the family of half spaces in d dimensions, and you ask how large can the epsilon net be for this thing, then we gave a concluding answer. Somehow it there was a long history before it, because people believe that for geometric systems we can do better than this bound that is coming from the Hausler and Wetzel theorem. And then they somehow believe that we can remove the log and then we would be left only with d over epsilon, and then gradually it was shown to be not true, and this is kind of the concluding result that you both need d and log 1 over epsilon. Okay, so the last, very last thing is this. I wanted to thank many, many of the people that supported me along the way, my parents, brothers, of course, my father, who was amazing and gave me a lot of inspiration, and my friends, Janos, Peter, and Andrei Mikhailovich Vygorodsky, who guided me and kind of taught me mathematics. So thank you all. Thanks for coming.
Значит, сейчас будут зачитаны отзывы, поступившие на диссертацию. Я их буду зачитывать, ну, в зависимости от отзыва, на русском или на английском, но потом основные выводы дублировать. Значит, прежде чем зачитывать, я бы хотел сделать какие-то общие выводы, потому что более-менее текст отзывов повторяются, ну, в частности, по замечаниям практически ни у кого нет замечаний, но, во всяком случае, существенных. Вот. И, соответственно, большинство, значит, оппонентов отмечают более-менее одни и те же результаты. работы. И вот сейчас Андрей их значит, представил. Не знаю, насколько будет ценность. Я буду все это повторять. Вот из отзыва в отзыв буду более-менее ну, в разном порядке с разными значит, приоритетами это зачитывать. Поэтому мне кажется, что я, наверное, буду по отзывам какие-то места отличительные отмечать, что вот в этом отзыве там на это обратили внимание. Вот. И в основном буду делать это на английском, на русском буду только совсем кратко дублировать, если отзыв был на английском языке. Значит, начну со своего отзыва, ну просто так вот они тут в таком порядке лежат. So, now I plan to conclude the reports on the content of dissertation, and I will consider only the core of these reports. Let's start with the report of Гасников Александр from MITT. Отзыв положительный, никаких серьезных замечаний нету, кроме вот что достаточно много опечаток было обнаружено. Вот. Ну и некоторые пожелания там, о том, что метод Хунты там можно как-то ну, чувствуется, что есть перспективы, можно интересно посмотреть там поподробнее некоторые вопросы. Но, в общем, никаких существенных замечаний нету, и уровень диссертации очень высокий. Значит, the topic of dissertation corresponds to the specialization 05-13-17, theoretical foundations of computer science. The dissertation is in accordance with the regulations on the award of scientific degrees of candidates and doctors of sciences at MIPT. Вот. Значит, это был первый отзыв. Он полностью положительный. Вот. Замечаний нет. Второй отзыв Гасников Александр Владимирович, доктор физико-математических наук МФТИ. Второй отзыв Канель Белов Алексей Яковлевич. Значит, тоже МФТИ, кафедра дискретной математики, насколько я понимаю. Вот, отзыв тоже положительный. Камиль Белов Алексей Яковлевич, MIPT. Excellent review. He mentioned that such dissertation is a great success of Rogorodsky Scientific School. The topic of dissertation corresponds to the number of specialization, and the work is done in accordance with the regulations on the award of scientific degrees of candidates and doctors of science at MIPT. Ну, то есть, в общем, аналогичные выводы, ну и также, значит, отмечается, что есть некоторые вот графические неточности, есть некоторые пожелания, но эти пожелания, я думаю, мы, в общем, в конце еще, когда будем проект заключения представлять, вы там увидите, мы собрали эти пожелания, и, в общем, это войдет в заключительный отзыв, можно будет как раз это обсудить в конце. Следующий отзыв Кабатянский Григорий Анатольевич, доктор физико-математических наук, Скалтех. Questions and remarks. I haven't found any drawbacks of the dissertation serious enough to be mentioned. И вот это более-менее соответствует большинству отзывов. То есть практически во всех отзывах в этой графе она, наверное, наиболее интересна с точки зрения вот того, что как бы вот можно найти негативного здесь. То вот, в общем, никто ничего не нашел. Это вот довольно характерно. По другим отзывам тоже. Ну и общий вывод такой же. The dissertation either give solution or advancement for many famous problems of fundamental computer science and risk mathematics. Вот. Ну, отзыв полностью положительный, также написано, что удовлетворяет всем требованиям. On my opinion, the dissertation satisfies all requirements for the degree of doctor of physical and mathematical sciences. Так, хорошо. Значит, идем дальше. Александр Васильевич Косточка. Я, к сожалению, сейчас не могу понять, откуда. А, вот, наверное.
Так. University of Illinois.
Да, 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 да. University of Illinois, Urban Champaign, да? Профессор, доктор физико-математических наук. Значит, отзыв Александра Васильевича также положительный. Ну, в общем, ну вот замечание за very familiar with prints in the dissertation and the abstract, but nothing serious. The level of the dissertation is very high. Вот последнее предложение, оно также во многих, ну, там, больше чем в половине отзывов отмечается, ну, с разной степенью превосходства. Вот. Ну, тоже вот довольно характерное перечисление и то, что отмечается большое количество журналов топ-уровня, в которых автор опубликовал свои результаты. Алексей Васильевич mentioned that the level of research is very high and mentioned a journal, top level journal, where Andrei published his main results. Александр Васильевич отмечает, что диссертация также удовлетворяет всем требованиям. Ну, в общем, довольно характерный отзыв. У нас такие все положительные отзывы. Значит, следующий отзыв Малышев Дмитрий Сергеевич. Профессор, доктор физмат-наук, тут как бы должность профессора, а ученое звание доцент, значит, ученая степень доктор физмат-наук, высшая школа экономики, Нижегородский филиал. Значит, отзыв Дмитрия Сергеевича также положительный, значит, в графе замечания. I noted several misprints, but the scientific level of the dissertation is really high. Вот даже так. Is really high. Ну, также отмечается, что диссертация, как и в других отзывах, соответствует специальности 05-13-17. The dissertation fully satisfies the regulations of the award of scientific degrees of candidates and doctors of sciences at MIPT. Ну, он полностью положительный. Значит, следующий отзыв Мощевитий Николай Германович, Московский государственный университет, механико-математический факультет, профессор, доктор физмат-наук. Отзыв на русском языке, поэтому я, в общем, буду зачитывать все на русском. Диссертация написана очень четко, серьезных замечаний у меня нету. Ну и, значит, заключение такое. В целом диссертация представляет из себя глубокое и законченное исследование. This report is also positive, and Николай Германович conclude that the result is very high. Следующий отзыв Шкредов Илья Дмитриевич, основное место работы Институт имени Стеклова, Российская академия математический институт Стеклова, должность профессора, ученая степень доктор физмат-наук. Отзыв также на русском языке, достаточно подробный. Вот. Ну, есть некоторые вопросы по диссертации, я, наверное, все-таки их зачту. Зачитаю. В диссертации имеются небольшие погрешности, например, доказательства некоторых лемм следовало бы изложить более подробно. Введение пропущено несколько запятых, это просто ужасно. Не всегда приведены все требуемые ссылки. Скажем, в автореферате автор ссылается на теорему 1.4, которая отсутствует. Иногда одно и то же слово идет два раза подряд, страница 100. Впрочем, все эти опечатки, смотри, например, и дальше там ссылки на литературу. И погрешности не имеют принципиального значения, носят характер описок и легко устраняются, тем более, что из контекста сразу видно, о чем идет речь. So, Дмитрий Илья Шкредов mentioned some remarks, but let me skip the details. Ну и вот заключение по-русски. Подытоживая сказанное, мы считаем, что все результаты работы обоснованы подробными доказательствами. Диссертация Купавского Андрея Борисовича, семейство множества, название диссертации, полностью соответствует специальности, вполне удовлетворяет всем требованиям, предъявляемым докторским диссертациям, а ее автор, несомненно, заслужит присуждения ученой степени доктора физико-математических наук. So, Илья Шкредов conclude that doctor dissertation satisfy all the requirement and it's well done. Окей, значит, теперь отзыв, я не знаю, как по-русски имя прочитать, Джоэл Катона.
А нет,
Дюла,
тогда
Дюла Катона, значит, отзыв, разумеется, на английском языке, тоже достаточно подробный, 4 страницы, значит, подробно описано вот в таких мельчайших деталях, значит, результаты какие отмечаются, но они будут тоже, в общем, достаточно подробно Андрей сам про это рассказал, они совпадают, в общем, с теми акцентами, которые были сделаны в докладе. Значит, Вот тут оригинально. Question and remarks вообще ничего не написано. Так что ни замечаний, ни комментариев никаких нету. И, значит, вывод такой. The topic of dissertation corresponds to the specialization. Я не буду называть номер. The dissertation is in accordance with the regulations on the award of scientific degrees of candidates and doctors of science at MIPT. Ну и вот, наверное, вот тоже надо зачитать. In my opinion, the scientific level of the dissertation is definitely above the requirements. Ну, то есть, отмечается, что научный уровень работы заметно превышает те требования, которые предъявляются докторским диссертациям. Вот, вот такой вывод. Значит, да, теперь я хотел бы... Значит, у нас будет еще два отзыва, но сейчас я хотел бы передать слово... We not stop here in terms of report on the content, but now I would like to передать слово...
Имеется заключение организации пробации, это Московский физико-технический институт. Значит, заключение кафедры дискретной математики. В заключении отмечается актуальность работы, цели, задачи, теоретическо-практическая ценность, обоснованность выводов, перечисляются журналы, в которых были опубликованы работы, 21 из которых индексируются базами Web of Science или Scopus. Отмечается, что диссертация соответствует специальности 05-13-17 теоретические основы информатики, пунктам 2 исследование информационных структур, разработка и анализ моделей информационных процессов и структур, и пункту 5 разработка и исследование моделей алгоритмов анализа данных, обнаружение закономерностей данных и их извлечение, извлеченная разработка и исследование методов и алгоритмов анализа текста, устной речи и изображений. Заключение принято на кафедре дискретной математики 24 января 2019 года. Имеется отзыв ведущей организации, это Хабаровское отделение Федерального государственного бюджетного учреждения науки Института прикладной математики Дальневосточного отделения Российской академии наук, подписанная ректором Быковским. Здесь отмечается также актуальность работы, научная новизна, подробно описывается каждая глава, теоретическая и практическая ценность и замечания. Ну, замечания здесь в плане обозначения, что не очень удачное обозначение, которое надо как-то пояснить. И такой еще был в некоторых местах. Автор производит схожие вычисления с использованием биномиальных коэффициентов. Скорее всего, эти вычисления можно было бы систематизировать и выделить в отдельный раздел, тем самым сократив объем. Но также отмечается, что соответствует паспорту специальности и утверждено 8 апреля протоколом номер 2. Подписано Илларионовым. Еще имеются два отзыва на диссертацию. Сейчас Александр Владимирович зачитает.
To conclude, at the end of this defense, we consider a conclusion project. This project mentioned Konstantin, and we discuss it. But now I would like to to announce two more report, Joel Spencer and Joel Spencer and not this order, Mubai Dhruv and Joel Spencer. I start with Mubai Dhruv. Тут также отмечается, что работа выполнена на очень высоком уровне. Вот, значит, но здесь есть вопросы, я должен буду их зачитать. Значит, questions and remarks. General questions comment. There were several recent works that study the final structure of interesting families and related questions well below the bound guaranteed by even the Hilton-Miller theorem. general formulation was provided by Jakovska Polchun Ruysinski. Excuse me. Where hierarchy of Turan number is formulated. This is the first item, as far as I understand. The second item, can the diversity result theorem 1.7 be taken even further in the sense described by these papers? That is, if the family is not a subset of some structured family, in this case H2 from the Hilton-Miller theorem, can one prove even better bounds? This was the first item. And the last item, the third item, one can ask the very same question for theorem 1.2, 1.10. If you do not allow stars, can we still get good bounds on the number of interesting families? What if we go one step further and do not allow subset of Hilton-Miller configurations? In fact, the same question can be asked for a virtually an extremal Turan type question, where the extremal configuration have some sort of well-defined structure, even perhaps for cross-intersecting theorems. E.g., for the Kruskal-Katona theorem, and one could restrict the maximum clique size, or forbid some other configuration, and ask how small the shadow can be. Here we would get larger and larger values for the minimum shadow until eventually perhaps we get shadows of the same order of magnitude as the original family given by a matching. Frankl has some related results here, but the point is to formulate and begin a systematic investigation of extremal set theory problems, as indicated by Жаковско-Польчун-Русинский paper. Вот. Так, ну самая сложная часть прошла. Значит, dissertation, ну выводы. The dissertation of Andrey Borisovich Kuparsky deals with interesting and important problems of extremal combinatorics and is a sound scientific investigation. It not only proves a new result on problems that have been researched for a while, but also develops new methods that should have impact well into the future. The topic of the dissertation corresponds to the specialization. The dissertation is in accordance with the regulation on the award of scientific degrees of candidates and doctors of science at MIPT. Вот. Ну, думаю, что, наверное, вот по этому отзыву надо будет, там будет момент, когда надо будет отвечать, наверное, вот.
Кстати,
вот я думаю, что в этом смысле мы можем сократить часть, потому что мы договорились, что по ходу доклада часть, ну если устроит, так сказать, такой ответ, это мы обсудим. Так, ну и отзыв Джоэля Спенсера, значит, тут проще, значит, по пункту вопросы и какие-то замечания. No questions or remarks. Значит, и вот последний пункт тоже хотелось бы зачитать. General evaluation of the dissertation. Kuparsky already has an international reputation, and so it comes as no surprise that this work title is an excellent piece of work. I enthusiastically recommend acceptance of this dissertation for the degree of Doctor of Physics, Physical and Mathematical Science. Ну, в общем, достаточно хороший отзыв. Вот, то есть все отзывы, которые вот были получены, они все положительные, и практически все вот без замечаний, но вот где-то есть какие-то небольшие пожелания, какие-то вот. Основное общее замечание, что диссертация содержит опечатки вот типа запятых. Вот, так что, думаю, такие замечания можно не комментировать, но вот то, что считаете нужным, сейчас как раз самое время прокомментировать. Вам предоставляется слово для ответа на эти замечания. So now Andrey can answer for these remarks.
So basically the remarks I should answer, I guess, are remarks of Dhruv, but the remarks of Dhruv mostly answered during the talk, so it's indeed interesting questions that Dhruv suggests to research, and many of the results, as I explained, can indeed be extended. But other than that, I really don't think I should go in more details.
That's it. Есть вопросы? Do you have any questions to Andrey? You may repeat. repeat your question from reports if Andrei doesn't answer for them. Okay, I guess all of us satisfied your answers. Okay. Now you may say a few concluding words for about you can gratitude someone, or, but I guess you already been done.
Yeah, I did everything at the same time. Well, as the people that I wanted to thank are mostly here. There are some friends that I didn't have good photo of, or I didn't have time to put photos in the last minute. And I also want to thank the committee, of course, for coming or for staying until my defense, especially the people that came from the US, which is really nice. And it's a pleasure to have all of you here. Thanks everyone for coming. I'm very happy that we didn't have enough sports for the people, so we had to reach out. Thank you.
Спасибо еще раз. Я продолжу на русском языке, потому что сейчас уже начнется, значит, такая бюрократическая часть. Я думаю, нашим западным коллегам это будет не очень интересно. I plan to continue on Russian, because now we start with bureaucratic part of our dissertation.
Мы избираем счетную комиссию открытым голосованием.
Количество трех человек.
Ну, все-таки не совсем. Но вот есть еще такой пункт, дискуссия называется. Мы можем ее не начинать.
Подождите, а вроде предоставлялось слово.
Таблицу надо.
Я понял. Подразумевалось, что это будет как раз часть с вопросами. Но давайте действительно отдельно сделаем. Или дискуссия без, как бы сказать...
Без дискуссии. Ну,
нет, без... со мной или без меня?
Да.
С вами, без вас я не бываю.
Значит, объявляется дискуссия.
If anyone wants to discuss anything with me...
Not
related to the dissertation.
Не обязательно с вами. Не обязательно с вами, Андрей, это важно. То есть мы можем дискутировать между собой.
Yeah, but
okay. Ну, если я правильно понимаю, то.
I still have a question. There was a result about, in fact, not result, but extension of result.
Yeah.
You that Rakerovsky did for zero plus minus ones.
Yeah.
And you wanted to do the same for intersection. But what is the correct definition of intersection in this way?
Yeah,
because for zero and ones,
yeah,
it's a natural one. It's, as you explained, it's yeah, by distance.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's known outside of the external Kuhn theory, it's known as a Johnson scheme.
Yeah.
So what is the analog on the distance linkage of the correspondent question?
Well, there are two natural definitions. One is, of course, the Hamming distance. I guess the one the one that would be closer to you is the Hamming distance, the number of coordinates that are not the same. But in this case, since the whole research for this minus 1, 0, 1 vectors was motivated by the problems in discrete geometry, we took the Euclidean distance, if you want. So the scalar products and the intersecting family in this context is the family of vectors that avoids the minimal possible scalar product.
Then you can compare what will happen if you consider so-called lead distance. There's a question what's a drawback of all this kind of distance. It's not corresponds to the Euclidean case for non-binary alphabet. For ternary and for quaternary, the lead distance is almost the same.
Okay, that's interesting. But and one more thing I can add is actually many of the methods for much are much simpler for Hamming distance. So for Hamming distance, when you look k square brackets to the n, the results for Hamming distance and also the Boolean analysis for this it is much more useful. While when you go to the scalar products, many of the things that you could do for Hamming distance do not work. But because of the applications, we want to figure out what's happening. And also the result of Rogorodsky that generalizes Frankel and Wilson theorem, unlike Frankel and Wilson theorem itself, is not tight. This is one of the motivations. Like, there is a big gap between the lower and the upper bound, exponential gap. Frankel and Wilson is tight exponentially, but for that one it's not. So this is the distance and the motivation.
Any questions? Okay, thank you. Так, ну тут достаточно хитрая ситуация, да, то есть формально нету научного руководителя.
Ну,
вот,
было написано результат? Нет. Не надо придумать.
Официально нет.
Нет никакого научного консультанта.
Но все мы знаем, да, что, в общем, кого надо в том числе поблагодарить, так что да, это надо разделять, сейчас идет официальная часть, поэтому, в общем. Ну, да, все мы знаем, что Андрей Михайлович к этому сильно причастен. Хорошо, значит, сейчас мы должны избрать открытым голосованием, значит, комиссию в количестве 3 человек. Предлагается комиссия из, я фамилию назову, Малышев, Попотянский, Канель, Белов. Никто не возражает? Окей, now we have to choose the commission. That will count in commission, we have to choose 3 persons from us, and we propose Kanel Belov, Kabatyansky, and Malyshev. Let's choose the. Okay, единогласно.
Нет.
Единогласно?
Он не знает. Abstain.
Окей. Единогласно. Замечательно. Значит, Константин, сейчас будут розданы, значит, бланки и бюллетени для тайного голосования.
Ну, расставим.
Да, значит, просьба на время всех выйти, остаться только членом совета.
Хорошо, я пойду, наверное, мне надо выйти.
Учите, пожалуйста, введение
решения. Если вы хорошо, то вы можете перемножить. Я в частном виде посчитал вот так.
Кстати, даже не нужно вычеркнуть, да?
Да,
конечно, да.
Так, еще вот здесь надо писать.
Константин,
так, где вы,
ну, как было давно,
ну,
Я ничего не помню.
Ну, можно возвращаться в студию. Да, да, нет, вы позовите всех обратно, если вам сложно.
У меня паспорт еще не взят. Паспорта нет, да, что могут пробрать?
Забирайте посольство. Он
говорит, Агрызского. Я уже сам не хожу в посольство. Агрызского.
You voted for? Shouldn't say.
Результаты голосования. Единогласно все проголосовали за то, чтобы утвердить, ну что, насчет диссертации защищена. То есть поздравляю. Вот, мне кажется, в общем, все можем поздравить.
Спасибо.
Вот.
Thank you very much.
The voting was solid, positive, solid. Сейчас вы получите проекты заключений, которые, вот если будут замечания, пожалуйста, вот отвечайте. Да, можно. Можно
начать.
Я не знаю, есть ли у всех ручки, потому
что я так понимаю, что
то есть дается время на то, чтобы прочитать это все. Да, согласен.
Предложение такое, принять. Уважаемые члены Совета, принимаем
давайте открыто проголосуем, принимаем ли мы проект заключения, значит, который был роздан. Принят единогласно. Спасибо. Да, на этом заседание объявляется закрытым. Хотел бы поблагодарить всех, кто принимал в нем участие.